born in the shadows of a refinery and steel mills all around it, Marktown has been around since 1913, predating that Model A Ford right there. It is a significant part of our history because it's one of the first planned industrial towns in the history of the United States. And that itself is worth the Chicago scene, I think. I'm Tom Barnes, Chicago scene, out in East Chicago, Indiana, to get a tour and an explanation of what this historic town is, was, and what should be for the future of it. I'm going to talk to Paul, who's a lifelong resident, who's been here. He's the unofficial mayor of the town. He's been here since 1953, the year he was born. Family, all the way back to 1917. So, that is the Chicago scene. That is Marktown, which is what you're seeing behind me now. All right, I made my way into the heart of Marktown, and I'm here with the unofficial mayor of Marktown, Paul Myers. How are you?
Just fine, thank you. And it's unofficial and unindicted, which right. In this city, that's an important concept.
So Marktown, what was it supposed to be? What is it for people who have never heard of it? And why is this story important? Like, let's start for the first question, though. What is it?
Well, it's an industrial housing complex that was designed to meet the workers' needs back in turn of the last century, back in 1913 and that, there was a huge overturn or turnover of workers. So they went to different plants in that, Westinghouse and others, and asked them, why did you keep moving? And they said, we need a place to raise a family. We need quality housing. We don't want boarding houses. We don't want a bathroom at the end of the hall that everybody uses.
Right, we want our own houses. We want running water, hot furnace, everything.
We don't want to all sleep in the same room. We don't want to be cooking in the same room. We want houses. We want something that we can be comfortable in, that we grew up in at home. And they sat down and they came up with it. And part of the plan was how dense you can have it and how it'll work and how a limit to how what the density can be. All of the homes are fireproof for the most part. You can still have a fire, but the structure itself will always be there because it's solid masonry.
And you've lived here, your family's been here, I mean, dating back to census records of the 20s. You've been here since you were born in, you say 53, right? And you've been the lifelong resident ever since. But more importantly, this was the first of its kind in terms of industrial towns, especially in this area, right?
That's right. And that was followed up later by the city of Gary, which was nothing but a steelworker town. And the city of Gary brought in a number of different architects to do different classes of housing. Including senior supervisors, but this was designed by one very important Chicago architect, Howard Van Doren Shaw, and he did major projects in Chicago, and this only four sections of the 30 some sections of this neighborhood was ever built, primarily because they got tied up with World War I. The government took over their plant. They had tons of steel that had to be refabricated mm-hmm. to use them for what they needed them for, and it was a difficult time for them.
Talk about the houses, the types that you have. You mentioned the gables and the street-facing gables, yard-facing, and the other. What, talk about the houses.
Well, there's only five floor plans in Marktown: a six-room duplex, a six-room single, a four-room duplex, a seven-room duplex, and what we call a Marktown quad from the original houses. We also had houses that were built in World War II, and they were brick four squares, much smaller, but they met the needs for the World War II housing. None of the houses here have ever turned, no one's ever turned a duplex into a single, which is probably best. I don't think anybody out here would need 2,000 square foot for any reason, or six bedrooms, but it's a comfortable neighborhood, it's a safe neighborhood. It always has been, and you're comfortable, believe it or not, walking down the middle of the street as you saw today. No one's out to run you over. Nobody's speeding through here at 60 miles an hour.
And everything here was built with purpose. The way the streets are, where you can park your car up on the sidewalk, that's on purpose.
That's right.
You know, everything was planned. The houses were planned staggeredly to maximize the, you know, the form of the house, the follow function in terms of your yard, and make sure that you have everything, you know, you're taking advantage of every ounce of space.
And that you weren't staring into your neighbor's back door.
Right.
You know, that they're always offsetting that. And I can remember when I grew up, all the porches were open and you could walk down the street on a summer night and talk to your neighbor sitting on the porch swing.
And this really was a town in itself because it had a school, it had a couple schools, it had a, you know, a pool with two pools, right?
Yes, a wading pond and then a regular pool with a bathhouse. It is a town, but it's also a town within the city of East Chicago. And we did have kindergarten first and second in one building, and third, fourth, fifth, and sixth in the other building. And 1930, the citizens or residents got together and went to the city and to the steel mill and wanted to convert the third, fourth, fifth, and sixth two-room schoolhouse into a community house so that people that weren't laid off because of the stock market crash and what it did to general industry could at least have one warm meal a day supplied by the people that lived here that worked. And it's a community center now. It's more of a children's center, and we don't have the access to it we'd like, but that's a political issue with the city.
And speaking of the city and the surrounding steel mills, that, I mean, this is nestled in an area surrounded by steel mills, a refinery, and the neighborhood, as the times do change, right? So some of the steel mills have substantially cut back on their production where there's just not as many jobs around, and this neighborhood has suffered a little bit for, and that's why I'm here, because I wanted to help tell the story of why it's important to remember, because slowly, you know, houses are going away. We're just becoming empty plots of land, which, you know, I mean, it's your childhood and everybody else that grew up here's childhood slowly being erased. So you're doing all you can to save it by the website that you curate along for Marktown, right?
That's right. It's a difficult thing. We go back to 1974 to the National Register nomination, and the final paragraph in that talks about how this could be restored, how it could authentically represent that period of time in this country. Unfortunately, the city administrations have never stepped forward to restore a home or to renovate one in a positive way that would bring other people in to do it. What I find amazing is that because of Indiana's tax structure, I pay $300 a year for a 1,000 square foot solid masonry house. It's owner occupied. That tells me that the retail value right now is $300.
Wow.
The refinery won't pay one dime more than $300, but I'm sure that there would be other people willing to sell to somebody if they were willing to raise the price.
Right, and that's what's happening. Refineries slowly buying them up to knock them down to basically, essentially, eliminate what is Marktown, right?
Well, above and beyond that, we have a city that's doing the same thing. They bought houses on back taxes, and they're going through them and checking for asbestos. There's asbestos in the houses, but it's not a problem. The only asbestos that was used in a Marktown home was to wrap heater ducts and hot water pipes. That's it. Mm-hmm. And they're all closed off where you can't get to them, and those heater ducts aren't opening up and spewing asbestos out.
So for people who want to be involved with this to help raise awareness to stop that from happening, what should they do?
Well, you know, if what you really want to do is sit down, we can find some landlords out here, that out-of-town landlords that'll sell houses, buy them, and make them owner-occupied.
Because this is part of a national landmark, right?
National Historic District.
National Historic District, the entire footprint that is Marktown.
Absolutely.
So that's why it's important to save, at the very least, to help tell the story of what this area of East India, or East Chicago is, which is Western Indiana, Northwest Indiana here, and how important it is for the city of Chicago, for the state of Indiana, and just the families that it served.
Well, you live in Chicago. How long did it take you to get here?
Not that long, 45 minutes, 40 minutes.
And we went through Whiting Park. Was it worth the trip?
Absolutely, worth the trip, every bit of it. What's the website people should go to learn more about what you do?
Marktown, marktown.org.
Fantastic. I appreciate the time that you took and the ride in the Model A over there. It's been a wonderful afternoon. Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming.
And that's the story of Marktown here in East Chicago, Indiana. TBARNAS at WGNTV.com. That's TBARNAS at WGNTV.com. If you have a suggestion for the Chicago scene, until then, I'll see you later.